Hello, and welcome back to 5 Minutes of Postgres. My name is Lucas, and today we're going to talk about Postgres 16. Postgres 16 is a new major release of Postgres where we have a lot of exciting features we talked about previously in 5 Minutes of Postgres. I want to give you a quick rundown of a few things that I find exciting, as well as a few things that you might have not known about yet that people in the community pointed out in the last couple of weeks. First of all, there's always two places you can look for what's new with Postgres. There's the official release announcement, which gets posted on the website, and then there are the release notes, which are usually more detailed, but you'll need a little more time to parse for all the little benefits that are new in this release. Here in the release notes, we can see a few of the highlights in Postgres 16. We previously talked about pgstat.io that I'm very excited about and I think will give a lot more clarity to when you have bottlenecks on your server. But there are a couple of other benefits here. For example, parallelizing joins with Postgres 16, so you will essentially see improved query plans based on that. You'll also see benefits from logical replication. Now you can logically replicate from a standby server, and you can have logical replication subscribers apply large transactions in parallel. If you recall, Postgres 15 introduced some of the SQL JSON changes, but then late in the release cycle, those were removed because of performance considerations. Luckily, Postgres 16, the community did another go at this, and so a good portion of the SQL JSON work is now in Postgres 16. And last but not least, there are a couple of improvements around vacuum freezing that I think will also benefit a lot of folks. There are a lot more things that are in Postgres 16, so how can we find some of the nuggets? Ryan from the PgSQLPhriday community asked himself the same question. And so the prompt for PgSQLPhriday 12, the 12th incarnation of this monthly occurrence, was to ask the community what they thought were non-obvious Postgres 16 improvements. And I just want to surface one of these here, which is the first post here by Ryan Lambert, where Ryan talks about how Postgres 16 improves infinity. What Ryan speaks about here is the change that says accept the spelling plus infinity in datetime input. Generally speaking, when you think of infinity in Postgres, it means either an infinitely positive or an infinitely negative value. In the context of timestamps, it can be beneficial to think about a value that's infinitely in the future. And so what's now supported in Postgres 16 is that you can cast positive infinity to timestamp TC here, and you will actually get a positive infinity timestamp. Now, one of the things that is important when you're considering whether to upgrade to a new Postgres release is whether there are going to be any performance regressions. And of course, nothing will replace testing it with your own workloads. And oftentimes for serious production systems, it does make sense to wait for a patch release just to make sure that if there are any obvious regressions that other people catch them first before you do. However, what I do like is that the community has different tries of seeing how performance regressions might have occurred. And so here, for example, Mark does a lot of testing between different databases. So tests MySQL a lot, he tests Postgres and such. And so here he just ran a test between Postgres 15 and Postgres 16 using sysbench and just checking if there's any CPU regressions, anything obvious. This here was a very basic test, but I think it's good to see that people are doing these type of tests and they're essentially confirming, at least right now, there's nothing obviously making new Postgres release slower. Last, I want to point out bidirectional replication using origin filters in logical replication. Oftentimes people are asking, how do I do active-active replication in Postgres? And there are third-party solutions that don't rely on the built-in logical replication to do this, but there's nothing today in Postgres yet that does that active-active type replication. Now, I would argue that Postgres 16 doesn't really give you that yet, but it does introduce an important aspect to this that will let you build your own solution more easily using core components. In this post by Vinesh on the Fushitsu blog, he talks about that new logical replication origin filtering. The general idea here is that you're annotating changes that get replicated into a node with having a particular origin, and then you can avoid the logical replication output plugin giving you those same changes again. If you imagine two nodes replicating to each other, the problem on Postgres 15 would be that you couldn't differentiate between a local change and a remote change. And so the improvement in 16 is that we have that way of saying, if this data comes from a remote node because it was replayed using logical replication from that remote node, then we're able to ignore it. And so this is a very important building block for an active-active setup using logical replication. There's a lot of caveats around this, and so I would definitely not recommend you just going ahead and saying, this is the only way I run my production databases. But I do think that this is worth exploring. Vinesh does go a lot into details in this blog post, which we won't have time to cover today, but I want to point out the limitations that he lists here at the end of this post. A lot of the issues have to do with when you're trying to introduce new nodes into such a setup and when you're trying to synchronize the initial logical replication setup. That requires a lot of fine-tuning, a lot of hand-holding, but I do think it's worth looking into this new origin filtering as a way to build some tooling around this. I'm really excited about Postgres 16. I think it's the best Postgres release yet, and I'm sure you'll see a lot of benefit when you're upgrading your databases. Thank you so much for listening. This was 5 Minutes of Postgres. Subscribe to our YouTube channel to hear about next week's episode, and talk to you next week.